Welcome, my dear learners, for this course on heat transfer. In this module 4, we will be beginning a new topic, that is convective heat transfer. So in our module 1 itself, I have explained about the basic modes of heat transfer, that is conduction, convection and radiation, and also laws governing these basic modes of heat transfer. So if I recall the convection mode of heat transfer, so we are heading to discuss convection mode of heat transfer in this module 4. If I recall what I taught in our module 1, the convection mode of heat transfer can be expressed as a derivative of conduction mode of heat transfer. This is because convection is a sum of conduction and advection. As I said, conduction is a mode of heat transfer in which heat transfer takes place due to the movement of free molecules or because of lattice vibration. So hence, here heat transfer takes place because of microscopic movement of molecules. Microscopic movement of molecules. Whereas, and also for convection to occur, fluid will flow. So hence, there will be a macroscopic mixing of one part of the fluid with the another part. So thereby, for convection mode of heat transfer takes place because of microscopic movement of molecules inside the fluids and also the macroscopic mixing of some part of the fluid with the another part of the fluid. So thereby, heat transfer takes place because of both microscopic movement as well as because of macroscopic mixing of fluids. Now, the law governing convection mode of heat transfer is that if I consider a fluid flowing over a surface, let us say the surface temperature be Ts and fluid is flowing over the surface, then the heat transfer taking place between this flowing fluid and the surface is because of convection mode of heat transfer. According to Newton's law of cooling, the rate of heat transfer is directly proportional to surface area between these two mediums times the temperature difference, considering surface temperature is greater than the ambient temperature. Let us take the temperature of the fluid as T infinity. So hence, from Newton's law of cooling, we have rate of heat transfer is equal to convective heat transfer coefficient times the surface area between the surface and the flowing fluid times the temperature difference. So this we have learnt in our module 1 itself. So I just recalled the convective heat transfer and law governing convective heat transfer, which is Newton's law of cooling. It is Newton's law of cooling. Now, moving ahead, in order to analyze the convective heat transfer, the famous scientist Ludwig Prandtl in 1904 determined the concept of boundary layer. According to this, we have two types of boundary layer. One is velocity boundary layer, another one is thermal boundary layer. Now, what is this concept of boundary layer? Let us consider a plate over which fluid is flowing. Consider a plate over which fluid is flowing. So, the plate nearing to the or the edge towards the flowing fluid is called leading edge. This is called leading edge, and the edge away from the direction of flow is known as trailing edge. When fluid flows over the flat surface like this, so in the layer of the fluid adjacent to the boundary, layer of the fluid adjacent to the boundary does not have slip. So hence, the velocity of the layer adjacent to the boundary is taken as 0. the velocity of the layer adjacent to the boundary, u at y is equal to 0 will be equal to 0. This is termed as no slip boundary condition. No slip boundary condition. According to no slip boundary condition, the layer of the fluid adjacent to the layer of the boundary have the velocity will be 0. There will not be any slip of the layer of the fluid which is adhering to the surface of the boundary. So this causes retardation of the velocity of the flowing fluid. So this layer causes retardation of the adjacent layer, that layer causes the retardation of adjacent layer. So thereby the velocity of the fluid will keep on increasing from the boundary to the free stream velocity or to the mainstream velocity. Let us take the mainstream velocity as u infinity. So in the y direction, the velocity will keep on increasing. At certain point, it reaches the velocity which is equal to free stream velocity, u infinity. Now, the point up to which, or the density immediate to the boundary, a thin layer will be formed within which the effect of retardation of velocity is felt because of no slip boundary condition. That is known as velocity boundary layer. So, inside the velocity boundary layer, we can observe the retardation of velocity of the fluid because of no slip boundary condition. And this boundary layer can broadly classified as two main layers, that is, in the vicinity of immediately to the boundary, a layer will be formed within which we can feel the shear resistance for flow, and layer above the boundary layer where in which we can employ potential flow theories, that is, inviscid theories will applicable above boundary layer. Within the boundary layer, we cannot use inviscid theories. That is, potential flow theories are invalid inside the boundary layer because we can feel the effect of retardation of velocity inside the boundary layer. So now, as I said, the velocity boundary layer is one which can be defined as that is, when a fluid flows over a surface, if I plot the leading edge and take the no slip boundary condition, then at a distance of x, if I plot the velocity distribution, we can observe the velocity distribution seems to be parabolic in nature in laminar flow. So as you all know, initially the flow will be laminar. As flow progresses, the transition takes place from laminar to turbulent and the flow will become turbulent. So now to understand properly, let me plot only for laminar region. If I plot for laminar region and observe, as I said, due to no slip boundary condition, the velocity of the fluid that is adhering to the boundary will be 0, it cannot slip, and the retardation is observed till to certain height above which we can observe the velocity of the fluid which is equal to free stream velocity or mainstream velocity, that is equal to u infinity. And within the boundary layer, if you observe, the velocity will retard, and at the layer adhering to the surface, the velocity will be 0, which is termed as no slip boundary condition. So that is, the vertical height from the boundary above which the velocity is equal to free stream velocity. So above this, we have velocity is equal to free stream velocity. So this height is termed as velocity boundary layer. We can take it as delta. So delta stands for velocity boundary layer thickness. Beyond this, you can observe the velocity is equal to free stream velocity. Inside the boundary layer, the velocity will be retarded. At the surface, the velocity will be 0, which is termed as no slip boundary condition. So this is about velocity boundary layer. So similarly, if I observe the thermal boundary layer, so coming for thermal boundary layer, if I consider the same flow athlete who are afflate such that the temperature of the fluid be T infinity. So I'll take the leading edge and I'll take the same case for a laminar flow. If I plot from the leading edge at a distance of x, if I consider the and observe the variation of temperature, let us take the temperature of the plate be Ts, and within the thermal boundary layer the temperature field will be experienced. That is, the effect of temperature Ts will be felt only within this boundary layer. That is, the temperature of the free stream fluid will vary only within this boundary layer. So if I observe initially it has temperature T infinity, as it reaches, moves towards the plate, its temperature will keep on increasing. Its temperature will keep on increasing like this. If you observe, its temperature will keep on increasing. So here the temperature will become Ts. So at any point, if I plot, the temperature of the fluid is not equal to T infinity inside the boundary layer. So its temperature keep on increasing and reaches the temperature of the plate itself of the fluid layer which is adhering to the surface. So if I plot for the non-dimensional parameter, that is, this is about the thickness of thermal boundary layer, which is denoted by delta T. So thermal boundary layer is one in which the effect of temperature field is felt when a fluid flows over the hot surface, and the temperature of the fluid within the boundary layer is not equal to its free stream temperature. So above this, it has the value of free stream temperature. Nearly we will take the value as 0.99 times the U infinity beyond the boundary layer. So beyond the boundary layer, we take it as 0.99 times the free stream. It is not exactly equal to free stream, it is 0.99 times the free stream. So here, if I define a non-dimensional parameter, that is Ts minus T divided by Ts minus T infinity, so which is equal to 0.99 beyond the boundary layer, beyond the thermal boundary layer. So beyond the thermal boundary layer, if I measure the non-dimensional parameter or term, that is surface temperature minus temperature of the fluid divided by surface temperature minus free stream temperature of the fluid, it will be equal to 0.99 beyond the thermal boundary layer. So the point up to which we won't get this numerical value, this 0.99, will be treated as thermal boundary layer. So inside the thermal boundary layer, the temperature field or the effect of temperature field will be felt. So if I plot this theta, variation of this theta, non-dimensional term, it will look like similar to the profile what we have for velocity boundary layer. So it will be parabolic if I plot for theta variation. So this is for variation of theta term. So this gives us the value of theta at any point x comma y, where theta is Ts minus T, and this gives the value of temperature T at any point x comma y. This is the temperature profile, so this is the theta profile. So beyond the thermal boundary layer, the dimensionless parameter Ts minus T by Ts minus T infinity will be equal to 0.99. So this is about the concept of velocity boundary layer and thermal boundary layer. Now, after this boundary layer concept, what we have studied, so this is about boundary layer theory, a brief introduction to velocity boundary layer and thermal boundary layer. The analysis of velocity boundary layer and the thermal boundary layer is an iceberg. We are not at all, just touch the tip of the iceberg also. Just I want to make you the understanding about what is the meaning of boundary layer and what do you mean by velocity boundary layer and thermal boundary layer in this lecture. So we are not addressing the numerical problems and we are not giving a clear intuition for these boundary layer theories. Boundary layer theory itself is a huge subject. The best book for boundary layer is Boundary Layer Theory by Stisling. Next, moving for the next topic of today's lecture, that is significance of dimensionless terms or dimensionless numbers. Before moving ahead to discuss the significance of dimensionless numbers, a very important term which I should define at this moment is equivalent diameter, or the concept of equivalent diameter is very important. Equivalent diameter. We can analyze the heat transfer for a flow over a flat plate or flow through a circular pipe for a known geometry. It is very easy for us to conduct the heat transfer analysis. If the heat transfer analysis has to be done for a complicated shape or for an intricate shape, then the measuring of heat transfer will become very, very difficult. You know, to avoid this difficulty, we are defining a parameter called equivalent diameter, which is formulating an equivalent pipe for that complicated shape, which gives us the same rate of heat transfer as that of that complicated shape. We are modeling that complicated shape with the help of equivalent diametrical pipe, which gives us same rate of heat transfer as that of complicated shape. And now the diameter of this equivalent pipe is defined as the equivalent diameter DE is equal to 4 times the cross-section area by perimeter. We usually take it as 4 times the cross-section area by wetted perimeter or wetted surface perimeter. So using the cross-section area of that complicated shape and the wetted perimeter of that complicated shape, we can determine the equivalent diameter. Now by using this equivalent diameter, I can easily determine the area of heat transfer, that is pi d square by 4. If it is taking through the cross-section area, if it is taking through the surface area, then it is pi d l. So where d is equivalent diameter, using which I can easily conduct the heat transfer analysis for that complicated shape by modeling it into the equivalent pipe. So this is about the equivalent diameter, which is very important in convective heat transfer especially. And next, coming for significance of dimensionless, significance of dimensionless numbers. Coming for significance of dimensionless numbers, the first one is Reynolds number, which is denoted by RE, Reynolds number. So Reynolds number is defined as inertia force by viscous force. Inertia force by viscous force. By knowing Reynolds number for a forced convection heat transfer, we can determine whether the dominance of inertia force is observed or the dominance of viscous force is observed. If Reynolds number is very high, then viscous force is very small compared to inertia force. If Reynolds number is small, then inertia force is less when compared to viscous force. And also this Reynolds number is very important in determining whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. For a flow through pipe, if the Reynolds number is less than 2300, then flow is considered to be laminar flow. If the flow is above 2300, we should use the turbulent flow correlations for analysis of heat transfer. And the flow is considered to be turbulent if the Reynolds number is greater than 2300 for flow through pipe. For flow through pipe, if Reynolds number is less than 2300, we take the flow as laminar flow. So hence, Reynolds number is significant in determining whether the flow is laminar or turbulent, which is the function of inertia force and viscous force. And next, dimensionless number of interest is Prandtl number, which is denoted by PR, who invented boundary layer theory, not by Prandtl. So Prandtl number can be defined as the ratio of kinematic viscosity to the thermal diffusivity. So actually the formula of Prandtl number is given by mu Cp by K. What you do is that you multiply and divide by density. So you multiply and divide by density. What you will get? Rho mu Cp by rho into K. We know that K by rho Cp is alpha, mu by rho is kinematic viscosity. That is, absolute viscosity by density is kinematic viscosity. So hence, Prandtl number can be defined as the ratio of kinematic viscosity to the thermal diffusivity. As we all know, thermal diffusivity is a parameter which defines how fast heat can penetrate in a given medium. Whereas the kinematic viscosity is a similarity of thermal diffusivity which gives us the transport of momentum, or the impulse force is propagating inside a medium. By knowing Prandtl number, we can determine whether the transport of heat is faster or the transport of impulse is faster in a given medium. Now, the next dimensionless number of interest is Nusselt number, Nu, which is very, very important. So, Nusselt number is given by H L by K for flow over a flat plate. It is also given by HD by K for flow through pipes. Now, I can rearrange it and write it as H divided by K by L, which I can state it as Nusselt number can be defined as the heat transfer taking place because of convection per unit temperature gradient to the heat transfer taking by conduction per unit temperature gradient over a constant length L meters or constant thickness L meters. And by knowing Nusselt number, I can determine whether the convective heat transfer is dominating or conduction mode of heat transfer is dominating. As I said, convection involves conduction in itself. And now, for convection heat transfer, the heat transfer coefficient is very, very important. By using Nusselt number, we can determine the heat transfer coefficient. That is the most important significance of Nusselt number, which helps us to determine convective heat transfer coefficient. And also, if you observe, convective heat transfer coefficient is directly proportional to thermal conductivity and is inversely proportional to the parameter L or length. So H is proportional to thermal conductivity and inversely proportional to length parameter L. And the last one of an interesting dimensionless number is Grassof number. So Grassof number, inertia force into buoyance force by viscous force square which is also given by the formula beta g delta t rho square L cube by mu square. This Grassof number is significant in free convection heat transfer. So if you observe, for a free convection to occur, the flow should be induced naturally because of density difference or because of temperature gradient. Whereas velocity is not an independent variable in case of free convection, because flow is taking place because of density difference, which is induced because of temperature gradient. So hence, the term beta g delta t is a governing term for velocity in case of free convection mode of heat transfer. So Grassof number is a significant dimensionless number for analysis of free convection heat transfer. I am using only these four dimensionless numbers because these four dimensionless numbers are very, very important in study of convection heat transfer among many dimensionless numbers. We have Peclet number, we have Rayleigh number, we have Euler's number, etc. There are many dimensionless numbers. Among the many dimensionless numbers which are important, I am taking only these four because we are going to derive the correlation for free convection as well as for forced convection, which involves these four dimensionless numbers. Hence, I discussed the significance of these four dimensionless numbers only. Now, let us derive the correlation for forced convection and for free convection by using dimensional analysis. Now, moving ahead for dimensional analysis for convection heat transfer, first let us discuss the correlation for forced convection. For forced convection, the dimensionless numbers which forms the correlation for forced convection are Nusselt number, Prandtl number and Reynolds number. Now, as you all know, whether the convection is because of free convection or because of forced convection, from Newton's law of cooling, the convective heat transfer coefficient is a function which governs the convection mode of heat transfer. So therefore, convective heat transfer coefficient is the depending variable for convection mode of heat transfer. So I want to determine H as a function of independent variables. Now, you need to determine the independent variables. We have a support of our data handbook. The refer heat and mass transfer data handbook written by C.P. Kothandaraman. We are referring 8th edition. In 8th edition, if you refer page number 112, in page number 112, you list out the parameters of these dimensionless numbers one by one. So if you see from page number 112 of C.P. Kothandaraman data handbook, for Nusselt number, we have convective heat transfer coefficient H and the characteristic length L. In order to avoid confusion, I will take it as D, and we have K. So Nusselt number is defined by HD by K. From page number 112 of our data handbook, I am writing these things. Coming for Prandtl number, Prandtl number is given by mu Cp by K. So we have mu, then Cp, K is already written, so it is not required once again. Coming for Reynolds number, for Reynolds number we have rho Vd by mu. So we have rho, velocity, we have already written the density, divided by mu, mu is already here, so let's put with velocity V. So Nusselt number is given by Hd by K, Prandtl number is mu Cp by K, Reynolds number is rho Vd by mu. So therefore, from page number 112, I have written the parameters which are required for forced convection. Now for forced convection, H is a function of these independent variables. Now I want to know the dimensional expressions for this one in terms of MLT theta. That is dimensional parameters MLT theta. In that form I want to express these terms. So therefore what I will do is that I will write down the units of this. Thereby it is easy for me to represent it in MLT theta form. Now coming for H. So H is, the unit of H is watt per meter square Kelvin, whereas watt is given by joules per second. So joules per second, meter square Kelvin, joules is Newton's meter, Newton meter per second, meter square Kelvin, Newton is kg meter per second square into meter by second into meter square per Kelvin. So therefore, meter square and meter square will get cancelled. I'll have to put kg per second cube Kelvin. So I'll have to put kg per second cube per Kelvin. Kg per second cube per Kelvin is the unit of H. Now coming for unit of diameter is meters. So therefore it is meters M. Coming for thermal conductivity. Thermal conductivity is H by L, that's all, because it is watt per meter Kelvin. Thermal conductivity K is watt per meter Kelvin. So therefore, I should divide this by length. So if I divide this by length, I will get it as kg per second square meter Kelvin. So I will get it as kg per second cube. Kg per second cube, meter inverse, Kelvin inverse. Now coming for viscosity. Viscosity is Pascal second. So mu is Pascal second, which is Newton per meter square second. Newton is kg meter per second square into 1 by meter square second. So meter and meter will get cancelled. Second and second square will get cancelled. Electrode kg per meter per second, that is kg per meter per second, kg per meter per second. Coming for Cp, Cp, unit of Cp is joules per kg Kelvin. Now we know that joules is Newton meters per kg Kelvin. Newton is kg meter per second square, meter by kg Kelvin. Kg kg will get cancelled. Meter square per second square per Kelvin. Left foot with meter square per second square per Kelvin. Unit of density is known for us, kg per meter cube. Kg, sorry, kg per meter cube. Kg per meter cube. Velocity is meters per second. Meters per second. So now I can write the dimension parameters, that is m and t theta, for these terms. So we have mass, that is m, second is t to the power of minus 3, Kelvin is theta power minus 1, meters is L, kg is m, L power minus 1, t power minus 3, theta power minus 1. Here we have mass m, meters is for length inverse, second is for time inverse. Here we have mass, therefore m square, second, that is, sorry, this is meters, right? So meters is for length, L square, t power minus 2, and Kelvin is for theta power minus 1. Kg is mass m, meters is length power minus 3. Meter is length, second is t to the power of minus 1. So we have expressed these terms in terms of MLT theta form. Now I can use Buckingham pi theorem to solve this. Now from Buckingham pi theorem we have the convective transfer coefficient is a function of diameter, thermal conductivity, mu, Cp, rho and V. So if you observe, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 independent variables, 6, whereas the dependent variable is 1, that is H is depending on these 6 independent variables. So therefore, total number of variables, there are 7 total number of variables now. So among these 7 total number of variables, we have used dimensional parameters as to define these 7 variables is m, l, t and theta, that is 4. That is, we have used m, we have used l, we have used t, we have used theta. We have used all 4 dimensional parameters, m, l, t and theta. So therefore, number of dimensionless numbers which are termed as pi terms, which is equal to total number of variables is 7, dimensional parameters are 4, m minus n is 7 minus 4, which is equal to 3. So we should formulate 3 dimensionless terms, whereas the formula for dimensionless terms or pi terms is equal to m minus n, where m is total number of variables, n is dimensional parameters. Now let us perform the dimensional analysis for this. Now you have to form three dimensionless groups. You have to form three dimensionless terms. What we should use is that the number of repeating variables should be equal to number of dimensional parameters. Number of dimensional parameters are 4. Hence the repeating variables for this should be 4. While selecting the repeating variables, we have a rule that the repeating variable selected should not form any dimensionless parameters or number. Second important thing, as much as possible avoid repeating dependent variable selecting as a repeating variable. And coming for the remaining three very important points are, select one variable which defines geometric property, select one variable which defines fluid property, select one variable which defines flow property. Now if I choose one which defines geometric property, so one which defines geometric property, I can choose it as diameter. Diameter defines the geometric property. Second one which defines the flow property. So one which defines the flow property, I will take it as mu, viscosity. So this is because of the reason, if you observe, both Prandtl number as well as Reynolds number involves this absolute viscosity. So therefore it is repeated in both Prandtl number as well as in Reynolds number, mu Cp by K, rho Vd by mu. So therefore I should take mu as the parameter which defines flow property. Next, coming for fluid property, I will go for density. Coming for fluid property, I will go for density. So I have selected D, mu and rho. I have only three repeating variables chosen now. I want one more. So selecting one more, you choose one which is repeating in these numbers. So the repeating in these numbers is thermal conductivity K. So if you observe in NR, we have HD by K. And also in case of Prandtl number, we have mu Cp by K. So therefore thermal conductivity is repeating in both Nusselt number and Prandtl number. So therefore choose thermal conductivity as one more repeating variable for this dimensional analysis. Hence the fluid property D, flow property viscosity, and sorry, dimensional property is D, fluid property is density, flow property is viscosity, and one more is thermal conductivity because it is repeating in both Nusselt number as well as in Prandtl number. I had a confusion in choosing the flow property as viscosity or velocity, but a careful observation reveals that this kinematic absolute viscosity is repeating in two numbers, that is in Prandtl number as well as in Reynolds number. Therefore choose absolute or dynamic viscosity as one repeating variable for flow property. So hence the repeating variables are D, K, mu and rho are the repeating variables. Now I can form three dimensionless parameters or pi terms. So three dimensionless pi terms will be, we have pi 1 is equal to repeating variables is d to the power of a1 and density to the power of d1, viscosity to the power of c1 and thermal conductivity to the power of d1. I will take one term, that is h. Next I will take pi 2 as repeating variables, d to the power of a2, rho to the power of b2, u to the power of c2, k to the power of d2, and I will take it as cp. Next, if I go for pi 3, d to the power of a3, rho to the power of b3, u to the power of c3, k to the power of d3, I will take velocity. So I form three dimensionless terms using the four repeating variables. One defines geometric property, fluid property and flow property, and one more I choose depending on its repeating. It is repeated in both Nusselt number as well as in Prandtl number, HD by K, mu Cp by K. So therefore since it is repeating, I took K as a repeating variable. So remaining three I used to form three pi terms. Now conduct dimensional analysis to find the dimensionless numbers. So first if I go for pi 1, we have pi 1 is equal to diameter is L, L power A1, density is ML power minus 3, that is B1, viscosity is mu, mu is M L power minus 1, T power minus 1 to the power of C1, and next we have K. K is thermal conductivity, is M L power minus 1. Thermal conductivity is watt per meter Kelvin, whereas H is watt per meter square Kelvin. So it is H into meters, H into meters, therefore this should be L. Sorry, we have done a mistake, kindly correct it. It is H into L. So a short observation is that it is H times length. So we know already for H, H is kg, second inverse cube, Kelvin inverse. So into L is meters. I think we have divided it. So I am extremely sorry. It is K is not equal to H by L. It is K is equal to H into L. That is thermal conductivity is equal to convective transfer coefficient into length. Then I will get the proper units. So K is watt per meter Kelvin, whereas H is watt per meter square Kelvin. If I compare these two, K will become H times meters. So K will become H times meters. So K is H times meters. So then it will become L power plus 1. Now it is L T power minus 3 theta power minus 1 to the power of D1. H is M T power minus 3 theta power minus 1. Now this is a dimensionless term, so therefore M power 0, L power 0, T power 0 and theta power 0 will be equal to M power B1 plus C1 plus D1 plus 1, and then we have L to the power of A1 plus, sorry, minus 3B1 minus C1 plus D1. And coming for T, T to the power of minus C1 minus 3D1 and minus 3. Coming for theta, minus 3D1 minus D1 minus 1. Now comparing LHS and RHS, we have D1 plus C1 plus D1 plus 1 is equal to 0, A1 minus 3D1 minus C1 minus D1 is equal to 0, minus C1 minus 3D1 minus 3 is equal to 0, minus D1 minus 1 is equal to 0. So hence if I solve, I will get D1 is equal to minus 1, D1 is equal to minus 1, substitute minus 1 here, so minus and plus, minus of minus is plus, 3 minus 3 is 0, so therefore C1 is 0, substitute D1 and C1 in, D1 and C1 in equation 1, C1 is 0, D1 is minus 1, minus 1 plus 1 is 0, so therefore B1 is also 0. Now substitute D1, C1, B1 in this equation. So this equation is A1 minus 3B1. So this equation, right? A1 minus 3B1. A1 minus 3B1 minus C1 plus D1. So now if I substitute and solve, B1 is 0, C1 is 0, D1 is minus 1. So take it to RHS, A1 will become plus 1. So we have got finally A1 is plus 1. So substitute these values in equation 1. So from equation 1, we are obtaining pi 1 as phi 1 as d to the power of a1. a1 is plus 1, rho to the power of b1, mu to the power of c1, k to the power of d1 into h. Like we take the original phi 1 equation as equation number 1, this is equation number 2, this is equation number 3. So therefore I will get phi 1 as hd by k, which is nothing but Nusselt number. Now similarly move for phi 2 from equation 2. From equation 2 we have phi 2 is equal to d. D is L, L power A2, rho is ML minus 3 power B2, and mu is ML minus 1 T minus 1 to the power of C2, and K is ML T power minus 3 theta power minus 1 B2, which is equal to Cp. Cp is L square T power minus 2 theta power minus 1. Now equating the powers m power 0, l power 0, t power 0, theta power 0 is equal to m power b2 plus c2 plus d2, l power a2 minus 3b2 minus c2 plus d2 plus 2 plus 2. Coming for t, minus c2 minus 3d2 minus 2. Coming for theta, minus d2 minus 1. Now equating LHS and RHS, we have b2 plus c2 plus d2 is equal to 0, a2 minus 3b2 minus c2 plus d2 plus 2 is equal to 0, minus c2 minus 3d2 minus 2 is equal to 0, minus d2 is equal to plus 1. So therefore if I solve, I will get d2 is equal to 1. Now substitute d2 here, it is minus 3 minus 2, d2 is equal to minus 1. Let me write it properly in order to avoid mistakes. Minus d1 minus 1 is equal to 0, hence d2 is equal to minus 1. D2 is equal to minus 1, put minus 1 here, it will become plus 3, plus 3 minus 2 is plus 1, send it to that side, it will become minus 1, so c2 will become plus 1. C2 will become plus 1. So substitute d2 and c2 in this equation. So d2 is minus 1, c2 is plus 1, it is 0. So therefore b2 will become 0. Now substitute all the three here. B2 is 0, you leave. C2 is plus 1. Therefore it will become minus 1. D2 is minus 1. So minus 1 minus 1 is minus 2. Minus 2 plus 2 is 0. A2 is also 0. So therefore, substituting to equation 2, substituting to equation 2, we have phi 2 is equal to d to the power of a2, that is 0, rho to the power of b2, 0, mu to the power of c2, that is plus 1, k to the power of d2 minus 1 times cp. So therefore I got mu cp by k. Mu cp by k is nothing but Prandtl number, pr. Next, moving for the last one, that is pi 3. So from equation 3 we have pi 3 is equal to d is l to the power of a3 rho is kg per meter cube to the power of b3, and we have m l minus 1 t minus 1 c3 m l t minus 3 theta minus 1 d3 l t power minus 1 l t power minus 1. Now if I rearrange and equate the terms, we have m power 0 l power 0 t power 0 theta power 0 is equal to m to the power of b2 b3 c3 b3 c3 plus b3, that's all. L to the power of a3 minus 3b3 minus c3 plus b3 plus 1. Theta to the power of, sorry, t, m by t, t to the power of minus c3 minus 3d3 minus 1. Next, theta to the power of minus d3 minus 1 minus d3. Here we don't have anything, that's all. Minus c3 minus 3d3 minus 1. So now, equating the powers of LHS and RHS, we left out with b3 plus c3 plus d3 is equal to 0, a3 minus 3b3 minus c3 plus d3 plus 1 is equal to 0, minus c3 minus 3d3 minus 1 is equal to 0, minus d3 is equal to 0. So hence we got d3 is equal to 0. Substitute here, so c3 is minus 1, c3 is minus 1, substitute to first equation, b3 will become plus 1. Now substitute to second equation, we have c3 is minus 1 become plus 1, b3 is plus 1, therefore it is minus 3, minus 3 plus 2 is minus 1, send it to RHS, it will become plus 1, a3 is also plus 1. So therefore, if I substitute to equation 3, substituting to equation 3, we will get pi 3 as b to the power of a3, rho to the power of b3, mu to the power of c3, k to the power of d3 into v. This is nothing but rho v d by mu, which is Reynolds number. So hence we have got the three dimensionless numbers, that is pi 1 is Nusselt number, pi 2 is Prandtl number, and pi 3 is Reynolds number. Hence we have pi 1 is a function of pi 2 and pi 3. So therefore Nusselt number is equal to a constant times pi 2 is Prandtl number to the power of m and Reynolds number to the power of m. So this is the correlation for forced convection. Nusselt number is equal to a constant into r e to the power of m pr to the power of n. Let me pause this video for a while so that you people can copy it down. Later we will perform dimensional analysis for free convection. Now moving ahead, next is dimension analysis for free convection. So if I go for free convection, free convection is bound by Nusselt number, Prandtl number times the Grassof number. It is not RE, it is Grassof, GR. So referring to page number 114 of our data handbook written by C.P. Kothandraman in 8th edition, if I distort the parameters, we will get for Grassof number, we don't have velocity, we have the term called beta g delta t. beta g delta t, where beta is inverse of temperature difference, that is coefficient of thermal expansion, and we have delta t, beta and delta t will get cancelled. G is meter per second square, acceleration due to gravity is meter per second square, so therefore I will get t to the power of minus 2, and here we will get the term as beta g delta t. So this is what counts the flow, whereas for forced convection the flow is exerted with the help of external medium as pump or blower, whereas for free convection it is because of density difference, so which is depending on temperature gradient delta t and the gravitational g. So hence this is term corresponds to velocity in free convection. So velocity should be replaced by beta g delta t, which is present in gr, and rest of the things remains the same. So here equation 3 will become beta g delta t, beta g delta t is our equation 3. So I corrected the value of k, d1 is minus 1, I substituted minus 1, this is also correct. Now only thing is that I should recalculate for equation 3, that's all. Let me recalculate for equation 3. Now if I recalculate for equation 3, we have beta g delta t, whereas the unit of coefficient of thermal expansion is Kelvin inverse, delta t is Kelvin, those two will get cancelled. So hence I will get g, g is meter per second square, that is lt power minus 2. So we will get only lt power minus 2. Why I am writing beta g delta t? It is lt power minus 2. It is lt power minus 2. So we have mb3 plus c3 plus d3, that's all. Coming for L, A3 minus 3B3 minus C3 plus D3 plus 1. Coming for T, minus C3 minus 3D3 minus 2. Coming for theta, we have minus D3. So this is equal to 0, D3 plus 1 is equal to 0, minus 2 is equal to 0, D3 is equal to 0. Hence we get D3 is equal to 0, substitute D3 here, so C3 will become minus 2, substitute C3 and D3 here, C3 is minus 2, send it to RHS, D3 will become plus 2, and now A3 will be, B3 is plus 2, so minus 6, minus 6, minus 6 plus 2 plus 1 plus 3, minus 6 plus 3, minus 6 plus 3 is minus 3, send it to right hand side, it will become plus 3. Now if I substitute and solve, I will get d to the power of a3 is plus 3, b3 is plus 2, c3 is minus 2, d3 is 0, and we have beta g delta t. So therefore pi 3 will be rho square d cube beta g delta t divided by mu square. This is nothing but Grassof number, we can check from page number 114. So hence we have Nusselt number is equal to a constant times Ra to the power of n, Gr to the power of m. So this is the dimensional analysis for free convection. If you learn forced convection, free convection is free. So buy one get one free. That is what we have. If you learn forced convection, dimensional analysis properly, the only thing for free convection is replace velocity by the term beta g delta t, which is responsible for flow in case of free convection. So accordingly, if you solve, we'll get the solution. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.